traditional Chinese. Drugs. Each drug has its own specific characters. In traditional Chinese medicine, the different characters of drugs are employed to treat diseases, rectify the hyperactivity or hyperactivity of yin or yang, consequently curing the diseases and restoring health. The various characters and functions of these drugs: properties, flavors, actions of lifting, lowering, floating and sinking, channel tropism, toxicity, etc. The theory of characters and functions of traditional Chinese drugs is based on the theories of yin and yang, channels and collaterals, and treatment principles of traditional Chinese medicine, and has been developed and summed up throughout a long history of medical practice. This theory provides the basis for drug analysis and application. Chapter 2: The processing of drugs. Drug processing is the process of treating natural drugs in accordance with the therapeutical, dispensing and pharmaceutical requirements before they are used or further made into various preparations. The processing consists of primary treatment of natural drugs and special treatment of some of them. Since most traditional Chinese drugs are natural with impurities mixed in when they are gathered, some cannot be stored for a long time owing to their tendency to deteriorate, some cannot be directly used because of their toxicity and drastic actions, and still some need to be treated in special ways to meet the therapeutic requirements. All drugs must be processed prior to application or preparation into various forms. Only after processing can drugs exert full therapeutic effects and their safe use be guaranteed. Chapter 3: The application of drugs. This chapter explains the application of traditional Chinese drugs under the direction of the theories of traditional Chinese medicine and in accordance with the actual condition of diseases, the characters and functions of drugs, and therapeutic requirements. The aspects to be discussed include compatibility, contraindications, dosage and usage of drugs. Chapter 4: Drugs for treating exterior syndromes. Drugs whose principal effect is to disperse pathogenic factors from the superficies of the body and relieve exterior syndromes are called drugs for treating exterior syndromes, or diaphoretics. Most drugs in this class are pungent in flavor. They can expel pathogenic factors from the superficies of the body or relieve exterior syndromes by diaphoresis. Their indications are exterior syndromes due to affection by exopathogens. Some of the drugs also have the effects of promoting the dispersing function of the lung, relieving cough and asthma, relieving pain, promoting skin eruption, and inducing diuresis to reduce edema, and can be used to treat cough or dyspnea due to impaired dispersion of the lung, qi, arthralgia due to wind, dampness, measles, German measles, edema, and so on. According to their properties, diaphoretics are divided into two groups: diaphoretics pungent in flavor and warm in property, and diaphoretics pungent in flavor and cool in property. They should be chosen in accordance with different syndromes. Other classes of drugs, such as those for resolving sputum to arrest cough, for clearing away heat, for promoting the flow of qi, for dispelling dampness, or tonics, should be added to them in line with the different accompanying symptoms and the patient's constitution. The dosage of this class of drugs should be of just the right amount, and as soon as the patient's condition is better, diaphoretics should be discontinued. Otherwise, excessive sweating may lead to consumption of yang qi and impairment of the body fluid. 4x, terrier deficiency syndrome with spontaneous sweating, fever due to yin di, efficiency, consumption, and deficiency of the body fluid in the later stage of febrile diseases, and for bleeding, chronic suppurative infection on the body surface such as sores and carbuncles, and stranguria, diaphoretics should be used cautiously or avoided altogether. The dosage of these drugs should vary with areas and seasons. Most of these drugs have an aroma. So, to prevent decrease in efficacy, long period of boiling shall be avoided. ZR R captor V heat clearing drugs whose principal action is clearing away the internal heat are called heat clearing drugs. Heat-clearing drugs are cool or cold in property with the effects of clearing away heat, purging fire, removing heat from the blood, detoxicating, and clearing away heat of the deficiency type. They are chiefly indicated for febrile diseases with high fever, dysentery of heat type, suppurative infections on the body surface and various interior heat syndromes such as the body surface and various interior heat syndromes such as interior heat syndrome due to yin deficiency. Heat clearing drugs are divided, in accordance with their properties and actions, into five types: heat clearing and fire purging drugs, heat clearing and dampness drying drugs, heat clearing and blood cooling drugs, heat clearing and detoxicating drugs, and drugs for clearing away heat of deficiency type. Four different syndromes, different heat, clearing drugs should be chosen. For interior heat syndrome associated with exterior syndrome, drugs for relieving exterior syndrome should be first used, or drugs for relieving exterior as well as interior syndromes should be given simultaneously. When there is pathogenic heat in the qi system akam, painted with heat in the blood system, drugs for clearing away heat in both systems should be used. Heat clearing drugs have cool or cold properties and tend to cause impairment to the spleen yang and hurt the stomach, therefore they should be given with caution in cases of insufficiency of yang qi and cold syndrome of deficiency type in the spleen and stomach with poor appetite. In cases where yang is kept external by excessive yin in the interior and a cold syndrome is disguised with pseudo-heat manifes, tachins, special care should be taken to make a clear diagnosis and see that no drug is given indiscriminately. Heat clearing drugs should be discontinued as soon as the condition gets better so that the genuine qi will not be harmed. Captor 6 expectorants, antitussives and antiasthmatics drugs whose principal effects are to remove the stagnation of sputum are called expectorants, drugs which can alleviate or relieve cough and asthma are called antitussives and antiasthmatics. As most expectorants also have the effects of relieving cough and asthma and antitussives and antiasthmatics, on the other hand, have the effect of resolving sputum, so they are generally referred to as drugs for resolving sputum and relieving cough and asthma. These drugs are further divided into three categories according to their principal functions: drugs for resolving cold phlegm, drugs for resolving heat phlegm, and drugs for relieving cough and asthma. Drugs for resolve, phlegm are mainly used for cough with abundant sputum, dyspnea due to retention of phlegm, or difficulty in expectoration, and diseases induced by phlegm such as epilepsy, convulsion, goiter, scrofula, deep-rooted carbuncle of yin nature and metastatic abscesses. Drugs for relieving cough and asthma are chiefly indicated for cough and asthma due to affection by exopathogenic fact, or an impairment of the functions of internal organs. In addition to the drugs for resolving sputum and relieving cough and asthma, other drugs should be used according to the cause of disease. For cough due to affection by exopathogens, diaphoretics should be used as well. For cough due to consumptive diseases, tonics should be added. For heat, phlegm syndrome with sticky sputum, it is preferable to use heat-clearing and lung-moistening drugs too. For cold, damp phlegm syndrome, drugs for drying and warming the lung to expel pathogen, nick cold, dampness should be added. For cough with hemoptysis, drastic and irritating sputum-resolving drugs should not be used because they might induce or aggravate hemoptysis. For cough at the early stage of measles, drugs for removing heat from the lung and promoting the dispersing function of the lung should be used as the principal ingredients, while antitussive drugs, especially drugs with warm and astringent properties for resolving sputum and relieving cough, should not be used so as to avoid any increase of heat or any disadvantage to the thorough eruption of measles. Captra 7 purgative drugs which can induce diarrhea and promote laxation of the bowels are defined as purgative drugs, or purgatives. Purgative drugs have the effects of relaxing the bowels, clearing away heat, purging fire, dispelling retained fluid and reducing edema. They are indicated for interior syndromes of excess type marked by dry stool, constipation, food stagnation, accumulation of heat of excess type in the interior, edema, and fluid retention. Purgative drugs are divided into three types: purgatives, laxatives, and drastics and hydragogues. Purgatives and drastic hydragogues, especially the latter, have potent actions and exert prompt effects, but they are apt to result in impairment of the genuine qi. The actions of laxatives are mild and they do not have the disadvantage of causing impairment of the genuine qi. When purgatives are considered, attention should be paid to the following: in cases of interior syndrome of excess type accompanied with exterior syndrome, usually the exterior syndrome should be treated first, or if necessary, interior and exterior syndromes are treated simultaneously. For patients with interior syndrome of excess type accompanied with deficiency of genuine qi, reinforcement with tonics as well as elimination with purgatives should be given in combination. Purgatives tend to cause impairment to the stomach qi, and therefore, they should be discontinued as soon as the symptoms are relieved. Overdosage of purgatives must be avoided. Captra 8 drugs for eliminating dampness. Drugs which can eliminate pathogenic wind and dampness and relieve arthralgia are referred to as antiaromatics, drugs with an aroma and with the ability to invigorate the spleen and resolve dampness are called aromatic drugs for resolving dampness, drugs which can clear and regulate water passages and excrete dampness are known as diuretics with dampness, eliminating action. Drugs with actions of removing, resolving, or excreting dampness. 8. Collectively nominated under the term of drugs for eliminating dampness, for they all eliminate the pathogenic dampness in the body in one way or another. Drugs for eliminating dampness are indicated for arthralgia syndrome due to wind cold dampness, edema, strain, urea, jaundice, lithiasis, and other syndromes such as retention of dampness in the middle, jaw, and dysfunction of the spleen transport, but their warming and drying properties and diuretic action are apt to result in impairment of Yunnan blood, so they should be prescribed cautiously to those who have syndromes of deficiency of yin and blood and impairment of body fluid. _ Captor 9 Interior Warming Drugs. Drugs which can warm the interior and dispel internal clot to treat interior cold syndromes are referred to as interior warming drugs. Drugs of this class are pungent and hot in property and can disperse the cold in the interior to normalize the yang qi or functional activity of the body. These drugs are indicated for gastric and abdominal cold pain, vomiting and diarrhea due to the attack of exogenous cold on the interior and spleen, yang, or for aversion to cold, cold limbs, pale complexion, clear and long urination, pale tongue, and thready pulse due to deficiency of yang qi accompanied with excessive cold in the interior. Some of these drugs have the function of recuperating depleted yang and rescuing the patient from collapse, and therefore they are indicated for yang depletion syndrome. Interior warming drugs should be dispensed together with other types of drugs. For example, in cases of attack of exogenous cold on the interior accompanied with exterior syndrome, diaphoretics should be used as well, for accumulation of O cold associated with stagnation of qi. Drugs for regulating the normal flow of qi should be added, for cold syndrome due to yang deficiency, the interior, warming drugs should be supplemented by warming and tonifying drugs. Interior warming drugs are pungent and hot and are liable to induce fire and cause damage to yin, they should therefore be used cautiously or should not be used altogether for heat syndromes, syndromes of yin deficiency, and for women in pregnancy. Captor X drugs for regulating qi. Drugs whose principal action is regulating the functional activities of qi and enabling qi to flow smoothly are called drugs for regulating qi. This class of drugs have the effects of promoting the flow of qi to relieve pain, regulating the activities of qi to check upward adverse flow of qi, or removing stagnation of qi to dissolve mass. They are indicated for stagnation of qi and reversed flow of qi due to disorder of the functional activities of qi, such as distending pain in the hypochondrium and breasts, hernial pain, and irregular menstruation due to stagnation of the liver qi, distending pain in the stomach and abdomen, belching, and acid regurgitation due to stagnation of the spleen, qi and stomach qi, or distress in the chest and cough with dyspnea due to impairment of the normal function of the lung in dispersing and descending qi, and nausea, vomiting and hiccup due to failure of the stomach in descending stomach qi. Drugs of this class can be selected for use together with other types of drug with regard to different syndromes. In cases of disorders of functional activities of qi due to obstruction of damp phlegm in the interior, drugs for eliminating dampness and resolving phlegm should be added. In cases of disorders of functional activities of qi due to dyspepsia, the drug for regulating qi should be supplemented with drugs for promoting digestion, for disorders of functional activities of qi, accompanied with hypofunction of the spleen and stomach, drugs for replenishing qi to invigorating the spleen should be added. Qi-regulating drugs are usually pungent and hot, and are apt to cause consumption of qi and yin. Therefore, these drugs should be cautiously used for patients with deficiency of qi or deficiency of yin. Chapter 11 Drugs for improving appetite and digestion and removing food stagnation. Drugs which are principally used to improve appetite and digestion and remove food stagnation are known as drugs for improving appetite and digestion and removing food stagnation of digestives. Drugs of this class can remove stagnated food and restore the normal functions of the spleen and stomach in transporting and distributing nutrients. They are also effective for indigestion due to the weakness of the spleen and stomach. These drugs are often used along with drugs for promoting circulation of qi so as to improve digestion of food. They are also given, according to the actual conditions of the patient in cooperation with interior, warming drugs, purgatives, or drugs for resolving dampness. In cases of indigestion due to deficiency of the spleen, drugs for regulating and reinforcing the spleen and stomach should be given as the principal remedies, with the drugs for improving digestion and removing stagnation as subsidiary ones. Effect spelling Chapter 12 Anthelmintics drugs with a major effect effect spelling or poisoning parasites Erica LLED Anthelmintics. Anthelmintics are indicated for diseases caused by parasites in the intestines, such as ascaritias, enterobiosis, cestidiosis and ancylostomiasis. Anthelmintics should be selected for specific parasites and supplemented with other types of suitable drugs according to the actual condition. In cases accompanied with food stagnation, drugs for improving digestion and removing the stagnation should be added. In cases with concomitant constipation, purgatives should be given as well to help expel the parasites. If the diseases is complicated by deficiency of spleen and stomach, drugs for strengthening them should be prescribed in addition to the anthelmintics. Attention should be paid as follows, in using anthelmintics. Administration of the drug on an empty stomach to ensure better effect, right dosage of poisonous drugs, temporary suspension of the drug in case of fever and severe abdominal pain, administration with caution for pregnant women, thiaget and weak. Chapter 13 Hemostatics drugs whose principal effects are to stop internal and external bleedings are called hemostatics. Drugs covered in this chapter have respectively the effects of stopping bleeding by removing heat from the blood, by astringency, by resolving blood stasis, or by warming the channels. They are indicated for various kinds of hemorrhage, such as hemoptysis, epistaxis, hematemesis, hematuria, hemiphysia, metrorrhagia, and metrostaxis, purpura and traumatic bleeding. Proper hemostatics should be selected according to the different causes of bleeding and actual syndromes, and they should be dispensed with other compatible drugs. In cases of bleeding due to invasion of blood by noxious heat, drugs for clearing away pathogenic heat from the blood should be added. For bleeding with blood stasis, drugs for promoting circulation of blood and qi should be added. for bleeding of cold and deficiency nature, drugs capable of warming up yang and dispelling cold should be added, for bleeding due to the failure of qi in keeping the blood within the vessels, tonics for reinforcing qi and activating the spleen should be given as well. When hemostatics are used, see that the side effect of hemostasis are avoided. Should there be any sign of blood stasis, never use drugs for removing heat form blood or astringent hemostatics alone. R. P. I$N, O, O, Chapter 14 Drugs for Promoting Blood Circulation and Removing Blood Stasis. Drugs whose principal effects are to make free the passage of blood in the vessels, promote blood circulation and disperse blood stasis are termed as drugs for promoting blood circulation and removing blood stasis, or drugs for invigorating blood circulation and resolving blood stasis. Among them, those with strong actions of invigorating blood circulation and resolving blood stasis are habitually called potent drugs for removing blood stasis. Most drugs of this class have pungent flavor, warm property, and actions of promoting blood circulation and dispersing blood stasis to clear the channels, remove obstruction of qi and blood, reduce swelling and relieve pain. They are effective for various syndromes due to obstruction of blood circulation and retention of blood stasis in the interior, such as amenorrhea and dysmenorrhea due to blood stasis, postpartum abdominal pain due to retention of blood, masses in the abdomen, traumatic injuries, arthralgia, sores, carbuncles and other suppurative Aiken infections, and pain in the chest, hypochondrium, and abdomen due to stagnation of qi and blood stasis. Because blood circulates smoothly only when qi is in normal flow, and blood slows down when qi stagnates, therefore, drugs for promoting blood circulation and eliminating blood stasis are often used along with drugs for promoting the flow of qi to strengthen their effects. Apart from this, other suitable drugs should be added according to the causes and symptoms of diseases. For example, in cases of stagnation of qi and blood stasis due to accumulation of pathogenic cold, interior warming drugs should be added. For pain in arthralgia syndromes, drugs for eliminating wind cold must be added. For treating sores and other pyogenic skin infections, drugs for clearing away heat and toxins should be combined. For the treatment of masses in the abdomen, drugs for softening andre solving hard masses and phlegm should be added. It is improper to prescribe this class of drugs to women with profuse menstruation. For pregnant women, these drugs should be very cautiously given or avoided altogether. Chapter 15 Tranquilizers. Drugs whose principal effects are tranquilizing the mind and relieving uneasiness are called tranquilizers. Tranquilizers exert tranquilizing effects either through sedation or through nourishment of the heart. They are chiefly used in the treatment of irritability, palpitation, or severe palpitation, insomnia and dreaminess due to deficiency of the heart, qi and insufficiency of the heart, blood, or due to exuberant fire resulting from hyperactivity of the heart. They are also used to treat such diseases as infantile convulsion, epilepsy, and mania. Drugs of this class can be selected for use according to the etiology and pathogenesis of the disease and used together with suitable drugs of other classes. For syndrome due to deficiency of yin and insufficiency of the blood, drugs for nourishing the blood and strengthening yin should be added, for syndrome due to exuberant fire caused by hyperactivity of the heart, drugs for removing excessive form the heart should be given as well, as for epilepsy and infantile convulsion, drugs for resolving phlegm and inducing resuscitation or drugs for calming thaliver to stop endogenous wind should be used as the main ingredients with the tranquilizers as the adjuvant. Heavy tranquilizers of mineral sources should be used in combination with drugs for strengthening the stomach and spleen and should not be used over long periods of time so as avoid any harm to the stomach. Chapter 16 Drugs for Calming the Liver. Drugs whose principal effects are calming the liver to check endogenous wind and relieve convulsion and calming the liver to suppress hyperactivity oft liver yang are called drugs for calming the liver. These drugs are chiefly indicted for dizziness and blurred vision due to hyperactivity of the liver, yang, and spasms and convulsions due to stirring of endogenous wind resulting from disorders of the liver. Some drugs in this class also have the effects of clearing away heat from the liver and are therefore effective for bloodshot, swollen, and painful eyes and headache due to intense heat in the liver. Drugs for calming the liver should be used in combination with drugs of other classes according to the causes of the disease. In cases of upstirring gulf wind due to intense heat, drugs for clearing away heat and purging fire should be added, for infantile convulsion due to phlegm and heat, drugs for clearing away heat and resolving phlegm should be added, for stirring of wind due to blood deficiency, they should be used together with drugs for nourishing the blood, for upstirring of wind due to deficiency of yin. Drugs for tonifying yin should be given as well. In addition, since hyperactivity of the liver, yang or upstirring of wind due to liver disorders is frequently accompanied with mental disorders, drugs for calming the liver are often used in combination with tranquilizers. These drugs are different in property, cold or warm, and therefore they should be used for different purposes. Drugs with cold property should not be used in cases of chronic infantile convulsion due to deficiency of the spleen and drugs with cases of hyperactivity of yang due to yin deficiency. Chapter 17 Drugs for Inducing Resuscitation. Drugs which are mainly used for restoring consciousness are referred to as drugs for inducing resuscitation. Drugs of this class have strong aromatic odor and remarkable action of stimulating the sense organs and restoring consciousness. They are chiefly used for treating loss of consciousness and delirium due to invasion of heat into the pericardium or obstruction of the heart by pathogenic phlegm. They are also indicated for unconsciousness of excess type like abrupt sundope in the course of terror, induced epilepsy or apoplexy. Loss of consciousness is not only observed in the blockage syndrome of wind stroke but also in prostration syndrome, and therefore the two types of unconsciousness should be differentiated. The blockage syndrome of wind stroke is caused by retention of pathogens of excess type in the interior characterized by trismus, clenched fists, full respiration and forceful pulse, while the prostration syndrome is cachexedby collapse of thagenyu in qi marked by open mouth, relaxed hands, faint respiration, profuse sweat, cold limbs, and a barely palpable pulse. Drugs for inducing resuscitation can only be used for the blockage syndrome of wind stroke, nave RF or prostradin syndrome. Besides, Blockage syndrome of wind, stroke can be divided into two kinds, the cold type and the heat type. The cold type is usually manifested as blue facial complexion, cold body, white tongue coating and slow pulse, whereas the heat type is generally manifested as flushed face, feverish body, yellow tongue coating, rapid pulse, etc. For the treatment of the former, warm drugs for inducing resuscitation should be used in combination with drugs for expelling cold and promoting the flow of qi, but for the latter, cold drugs for inducing resuscitation must be given along with drugs for clearing away toxic heat. All drugs for inducing resuscitation are used only for emergency and symptomatic relief. So they should only be given temporarily but not over long periods of time to avoid consumption of the primordial qi. Also, most drugs of this class is aromatic and their aroma id highly volatile, and for this reason, they are usually used in bolus and powder with exception of only a few for use in decoction. Chapter 18 Tonics drugs which can tonify the deficient qi, blood, yin, and yang of the body, enhance the body resistance to diseases, and be used in the treatment of various deficiency syndromes are known as tonics, or drugs for deficiency syndromes, or supplementing and nourishing drugs. Deficiency syndromes are further divided into deficiency of qi, of yang, of blood, and of yin, and accordingly, tonics are divided into four kinds, drugs for tonifying qi, yang, blood and yin. Because the qi, blood, yin, and yang in the human body are interdependent, deficiency of yang is often accompanied with deficiency of qi, and in turn, deficiency of qi is most likely to develop into or lead to deficiency of yang. The deficiency of yang and qi indicates the physiological hypofunction of the body. Similarly, deficiency of yin is usually accompanied with deficiency of blood, and deficiency of blood is liable to cause deficiency of yin. Deficiency of yin is usually accompanied with deficiency of yin. Deficiency of blood and yin indicates the consumption of vital essence, blood, and body fluid. For these reasons, drugs for tonifying qi and yang and drugs for tonifying blood and yin are often used together for mutual reinforcement. In case deficiency of qi and blood occurs, or deficiency of yin and yang exists at the same time, a therapy of tonifying both qi and blood, or both yin and yang, should be recommended. In case that pathogens of excess type are still present and there is no sign of deficiency of the vital qi, tonics should not be used so as to avoid any interference in the elimination of pathogens which may aggravate the condition. However, in cases of coexistence of pathogens and deficiency of the vital qi, suitable tonics can be used in addition to drugs for eliminating pathogens in order to strengthen the body resistance to diseases for removing pathogens. Being used over a long period of time, some of the tonics may impede digestion, so they can be supplemented with drugs for strengthening the spleen and stomach. Effective for deficiency as they are, tonics should not be abused, for they may give rise to other problems. Chapter 19 Astringent drugs which are chiefly used to arrest or reduce excessive loss of the vital essence and body fluid are called astringents. Most drugs of this class are sour or astringent in flavor and have the effects of strengthening the superficial resistance to stop perspiration, Astringing the bowels to arrest diarrhea, keeping the kidney essence, reducing urination, astringing the lung to relieve cough, and checking hemorrhage, curing leukorrhagia, etc. Astringents are indicated for syndromes of incessant and excessive loss of the body fluid or vital essence such as spontaneous sweating, night sweat, chronic diarrhea and dysentery, seminal emission, spermatorrhea, enuresis, frequent urination, chronic cough, asthma of insufficient type, mitre, hagia and metros taxis, and protracted leukorrhagia due to general debility resulting from protracted illnesses and inconsolidation of the vital chi. Because the root cause of the syndromes of incessant and excessive loss of the body fluid and vital essence is deficiency of the vital chi, therefore astringents must be used in combination with necessary tonics, in the treatment of spontaneous sweating due to deficiency of chi. Chi tonics should be added, to treat night sweat due to yin deficiency, yin tonics should be used as well, to arrest chronic diarrhea due to deficiency of the spleen, drugs for reinforcing the spleen as well as astringents should be used, for seminal emission due to deficiency of the kidney, tonics for strengthening the kidney should be combined. Astringents have the side effects of retaining the pathogenic factors, so they should be avoided in cases of pathogenic factors of excess type. Catper XX antineoplastic drugs which have antineoplastic effects according to reports in historical literatures, modern clinics and pharmacological experiments are referred to as antineoplastic drugs. In the light of reports from various parts, there are more than 100 antineoplastic drugs, which can be divided into such kinds as clearing away heat and toxin, promoting bold circulation to remove stasis, clearing away phlegm and dispersing masses, resolving tumors and lumps, and strengthening the body resistance and tonics. It is reported in pharmacological studies that these drugs can obviously inhibit experimental tumors in animals or human tumors in vitro. The effect modes are destroying tumor cells directly and inhibiting growth, protein biosynthesis, metabolism, division, and reproduction of tumor cells. They can also raise body immunity, enhance body metabolism and promote functions of reticule endothelial cells. Clinically, they have effects of relieving symptoms and prolonging survival time. Some cases of cure are reported. Some antineoplastic drugs have synergistic actions with chemotherapy and radiotherapy so as to raise curative effects. The administrations are various. They can be decocted alone for taking or decocted with other medicines to make compounds for taking. Some of them are ground into powder and mixed with other medicines to make boluses and powder for taking, or smashes and ground into powder for external use. A lot of tablets, syrup, and injection, make of effective components extracted from these drugs, are used orally, intramuscularly, intravenously, or in basal part infiltration of tumor. Dosage and methods of preparation should be taken into consideration, for most of these drugs are poisonous.